This episode of Brew Bloods is brought to you by Pint Hub. Get your first beer on the house every single day. Download the app and use the promo code BrewBloods to get your first month for $1.
You're listening to the Screaming Pods Network.
Drink beer. Think beer. You're listening to Brew Bloods.
Brew Bloods episode 139.
Yes.
We are back on the scene finally. And one thing I haven't heard, and we've had a lot go on, so many events, so many luxurious events going on while you're gone. But the most luxurious was Dustin the Whale hit Vegas. So I want to hear all about it. You've not told me a single detail about your trip to Vegas. I want to hear how you took it all from the casinos.
Well, on the casino front, I did a surprisingly limited amount of gambling.
It's because you took it all from him in one hand, right?
Pretty much one day, and I won, you know, like $10 and pretty much stopped, which is...
$10 million, of course.
That's what I call millions, so, or just dollars.
Hey, yes. Mr. Whale, we've had enough of you. Get out of here. We'll come in your room. Get out of here, Mr. Whale.
That's what I call dollars. Yeah, they know. When I'm like $10, they know.
Yeah, yeah. You like to speak in shorthand, dollar shorthand, because you're so wealthy.
Absolutely, yeah.
You bet it all on red and black in one hand.
That's true. And somehow I won money.
So you came out ahead, yes.
But yeah, the beer scene, since we've been there so often, again, has not changed much. It's pretty much the same couple of breweries that are always there. Did not make it down to Fremont Street this time. We went for a friend's birthday. They wanted to do that. Then we kind of talked them out of it because there's not really a whole lot going on in Fremont, especially if you're not going to do the zip line. So we didn't go to that brewery. Did stop by.
Wait, do you mean this time Band of Horses was not playing exclusively for you again?
That's true. That was just one time, yes. That was a once-in-a-lifetime
concert
time.
For two?
Yeah. You could have gone to that.
I was not invited to that.
I invited you.
From what I remember,
you just didn't want to shell out the money.
Ticket for me, yeah, the $200 ticket for an exclusive concert by a Band of Horses. Yes, I was not going to shell that out.
One of three bands, so you would have had a three-concert experience.
Me. Probably Explosions in the Sky. And,
a bunch of free alcohol, too.
Some other animal band, yeah.
You could have drank your way into $200 in Vegas.
I guess I could have. Instead, I chose to spend 8 hours consecutively at a blackjack table.
Did you build up a bunch of money to lose it all because you accidentally bet it all or something like that?
Oh, no. That was at the digital poker, digital blackjack machine. I hit the wrong button one time. Yeah, that was bad. No, at the regular, I did pretty good at the regular blackjack table. But
okay. Well, that's good.
Just only got up to pee once in a while.
Should have brought you over there then. Yeah. This time.
But you're Mr. Whale.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if I wanted to go with the true whale that actually wins, I should have brought you there. But
well,
again, the only local one that's really around there, and you've experienced them, is Sin City. Yeah, I went to the Venetian, went to their bar stop again, had their double IPA again, which I always like. But you know, nothing new to report.
Right?
They don't ever have any staff there that I could actually interview. So
was this the little like?
This is the kiosk,
stop, or was this?
This is like the little kiosk inside the hotel.
Where is the proper brewery?
I don't know. They have a big storefront that actually is right off the strip, but we were driving around going somewhere else, and I saw it. I had never seen that before. So maybe that's the proper brewery. I don't know. But the little stop in Venetian, yeah, there's nobody there. So I went there, had that, and then went to an oxygen bar, and that was about it that day.
So you decided instead of partaking in craft beer, you decided to partake of craft oxygen.
Craft oxygen, yes.
Craft O2.
With some very nice massages, but it was very pleasant.
Happy ending?
Unfortunately not, no.
Yeah. Even though you demanded, you're dusting the whale. You're old D-dubs.
I wasn't willing to pay extra.
You were dressed up as a whale in a tuxedo.
I think that kind of turned everybody off. I dressed as an actual whale. I didn't really get the reference.
You're the whale furry. I'm sure there's a furry convention going on. They're probably used to that. You could probably get a furry happy ending on that.
Does whale...
Are whales
count as
furries?
A furry? Yeah, I don't know. Do you have to actually have fur to be a furry? Or
I figured if you're
a furry, just a thing when you dress up like an animal.
It's at least furry adjacent, right?
Yeah, it's close.
I mean, it's still in the mammal community. Yeah.
Is it a scaly or something? I don't know. I don't know what you'd call a whale.
Do whales have scales?
I don't know. Is it a skinny, I guess? I don't know.
I don't know. What do whales have? Do whales have skin?
I think so.
But do they have
scales? What's their thing that covers their body? It's skin, right? I would call that skin.
They're covered in a loose burlap sack that they're born with.
Exactly.
I don't know what whales are born with, actually. I don't think that's a question that can ever be answered.
It's impossible to find out.
I don't think it's
especially
scales,
not on a
though.
Beer short. Sure, show.
I don't think that, yeah, I don't think that's... But they are furry adjacent. They are mammals.
Oh, yeah, it's definitely furry
adjacent.
They
have push-outs, just like other mammals.
That's true.
They don't, like, blow their load all over eggs.
That's very true.
So, I don't know.
That seems very spare. I'm glad that's not the human way.
To blow your whale load
all
over?
The only time you blow a load is on eggs somewhere. You know, that would suck. Yeah. But that's not the human way.
Yeah, like if crocodiles had taken over as the dominant species, would they, when they're eating other bird eggs for dinner, would they be tempted to just spray all over their dinner?
Maybe so.
And do crocodiles spray?
I don't know. That's, you're going down paths I don't understand.
I don't know.
For sure.
So anyways, back to your furry convention as Dustin the Whale.
But yeah, that was really the only beer experience I had. We also did a stop by the some place called like Beverage World or something really lame on the way to the hotels.
Generic.
You know, just to have some stock in the room, which is always a good way to go.
Yeah.
And yeah, you know, went with the standard Founders IPA because there wasn't really anything local there either. I get it's Beverage World. Maybe they don't have the biggest selection, but they did have a pretty good craft beer selection, but almost all of it was like California-based stuff.
That makes sense.
Yeah, I know. I thought maybe Nevada in general would have maybe a few more options that they would be presenting, but yeah, I really didn't see much.
It seems to me that Las Vegas is much more concerned with the liquor consumption.
Oh, absolutely.
Than they are beer consumption.
Yes. I mean, they're covering their base a little bit with that. So yeah. If you're a craft beer person, you're like, you can find an IPA. But, you know, and the fact we've talked about before, if you're betting at a casino, they will at least give you like a Goose Island or something. So
right.
Something there, a Goose Island IPA. But yeah, they're not real into the craft beer scene unless you go to one or two very specific places. They just don't seem to care.
And they tore down our one bar.
They did, yeah. They tore down the sports bar in the Monte Carlo. They also tore down the Diablos, and that's totally gone now. So they're making it completely high-end and, you know, for true whales. Not furry whales like myself. It's for true whales. So, yeah, it's kind of annoying. I don't really like that renaissance of the super high-end stuff. But they're not renaissance, but the trend towards that.
I know what you mean. The renovation towards the...
Yeah, I like something that's a little... Make it a little trashy, you know? Even on the Strip, you can have some trashy hotels. Not Hooters trashy, but... You know, trashy.
Well, you did also stay at the Areola, right? The Areola upper scale
that
hotel.
Is true. Yeah, and I wouldn't necessarily recommend it.
Really? Not a good hotel?
It was okay. It
really?
Yeah, it wasn't that great.
Would have been better to stay at the pre-remodeled Monte Carlo?
Yeah, actually.
Really?
Yeah. Even though it was 90s, you know, they have all this modern technology in the Aria rooms, and it's like, half of it didn't work. Like, most of the bulbs were out. And
awesome.
I don't know, I was pretty unimpressed with the thing in general.
Did you complain to the front desk and say, look,
no, I didn't, because
I'm Dustin the Whale.
We're barely in there. So.
I need bulbs, eh? Oh, barely look at this guy up and down the strip.
Yeah,
bet his ass off left and right.
Did visit New York again, which is probably my favorite lobby on the strip.
Would you like to rank the lobbies while we're here?
You want to go through all of them?
We're a rating show. I think you need to rank the lobbies.
I don't think I want to go through all 30 hotels.
Top five, bottom five lobbies.
Yeah, well, we'll do that next time. We'll do that in episode 140.
And we don't set the limit to Vegas. We can limit it. We can go
any
like,
lobby
lobbies around the world. Yeah.
And then after that, conference rooms.
Maybe we need to start a lobby cast. Favorite lobbies.
Yes, shortly followed by conference rooms.
How do you rank
rooms?
The Kroger lobby down the street?
Very poor.
With its one shopping basket.
Very smoky and very poor, yes. Overall, a good trip. Enjoyed it. Just kind of limited the drinking and gambling this time. And I don't know, just wasn't as motivated as usual. Huh. I think I've been there too much lately. I need like a little bit of a break and then go back.
When you clean up with $10 million in one hand, I can understand just bowing out.
That's very true, yes.
10 large. Or 10 small to yourself.
10 bills, yeah.
So we haven't really touched on brews in the news lately, mostly because we haven't done a show because we've been busy.
That's a very good point.
You know, cash and
outsourcing
and
the show.
And route. Yeah, we've been outsourcing. Next, we're going to do a true H-1B visa and outsource it to India.
Yeah, that's very true. Breweries. We'll give them a script and they'll talk you know, for us. But
yeah, exactly. Yeah.
It'll be weird.
It'll be, yeah. Or it could be awesome. You never know.
Yeah, that's true. It'll take a little bit of adjustment. We're not doing like a whole big news segment here.
Yeah.
We're actually going back into reviews again.
Yeah.
So hopefully you enjoy that. And we're going to do that for the next couple episodes. But there were some highlights I wanted to touch in each episode. And this one was the fact that the Brewers Association did announce their 2018 World Beer Cup Award winners. And
the only World Cup that I care about, personally.
Exactly. And, you know, we always talk about the fact that, our IPA is kind of trending down. They've been overdone. They're associated with craft beer, but people are getting tired of them, so they need a new twist on them. Well, the most entered category was the American-style IPA with 377 entries, which is almost 100-some-odd more than the or 200 more than the next highest,
right,
which was an Imperial IPA.
And well, I didn't say that they're not popular. I'm not
laying that on you. I'm saying we've talked about that. Like, well, what's the new trend? Is everybody going to Goza's?
Well, the new trend is New England IPA. I mean, it's...
Yeah, but this is just a standard American-style IPA. Maybe New England IPA's fallen that, but I'm just saying, I think it's interesting that that's still kind of the kind of the top by far. I mean, it's not even the barrel-aged stouts and things like that. I mean, there are, you know, 190 entries on that, 196 entries for barrel-aged strong beer, which I don't really know the difference in strong beer and strong stout. But I guess, obviously, different base of some sort, kind of an idiom in that
maybe
front.
One is just, it could be ales, stouts, brown ales, something like that.
Yeah, just something that's barrel-aged at all. Yeah, it doesn't just have to be a stout, obviously. But
yeah, it could be generic ale.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, I knew IPAs were still strong, but I didn't realize they were quite that strong, that would still be the number one category, you know, entered like that. They said that they are, and speaking of craft beer growth, there were 66 countries represented, a 20% increase year over year. So that's pretty interesting to me. I guess it's getting more global.
Yeah, that's what I have to think because, yeah, I mean, the craft beer growth is spreading outward. It's kind of on the decline here in the States, but I guess that trend, the popularity, it's got to spread somewhere. I mean, that's why, look at Stone going over to Germany. And,
sure.
You know, we've seen some start to come off slowly out of China. We've heard about a few in Mexico. Yeah, I mean, it makes sense.
And I would say even if you want to say it's on the decline here, I think it's maybe
flattening
at least,
out.
Yeah, leveling out. Yeah, it's not just a straight up shot like it was for a while.
Alcohol sales are down overall.
Yeah,
1% to 2%. But, yeah, craft beer is probably more flat than anything.
Yeah.
It does feel like, and maybe this is just my misperception.
Yeah.
It does feel like the interest in craft beer is kind of waning, like socially.
yeah, maybe somewhat. Well, I think that's partially because there's less new hotness, too. I think it's kind of, I bet there's still as many people actually just drinking stuff, but it's just when, especially in DFW, when things were booming so much.
Yeah.
I'm not saying they've stopped by any means, but when they were booming so much that everybody was like, oh, did you do this? Mm. Even going back to like the, you know, DFW Talk Craft Beer Facebook group or whatever. I think even that seems to have slowed down a little bit.
Wouldn't know because I don't pay attention to it anymore.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I'll look over every now and again just to see what's up. But
you go in there and say, hey, what's up?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But just speaking to the slowness in the United States, I mean, we were still by far the country with the most awards, 242 versus Canada and Germany, who had 14 and 9. So dominating. Makes sense that we would dominate, especially when American-style IPAs are number one. Not that other countries don't do that, but it would make sense. And the countries with the highest winning rate, Belgium, was the highest. So I guess people do like those Belgians a lot more than we tend to.
Yeah.
One note that I didn't put on here is that Panama was, this was their first year to actually win something. So never think of those countries near the equator as having anything but light lagers. So it's kind of interesting that they would actually submit, I believe it was a pale ale that won. And, you know, actually compete with all these other countries' beers and actually, you know, take an award. So it's interesting.
Hopefully they came out to Van Halen's Panama.
Of course, yeah.
As they walked up there to get their medal.
But, yeah, it's you know how it is. We've been to the Caribbean and
that's
very rare to have anything. You know, I think an IPA would fit fine in that environment.
I agree.
So I'm surprised those aren't a little more prolific. But I get why stouts aren't, but those other ones I could see being a little stronger.
Sticky, moist heat.
Yeah.
A
big, thick stout's kind of hard to take when it's so moist.
Yeah, it's so moist. When you're dripping all over.
Absolutely.
You don't want a big, strong stout in your face.
That's very true.
Or do you?
Maybe you do.
Something we've been planning for a while is we're going to pay homage, tributes. We're going to feast. Pay fealty to one of our loyal listeners. That's JohnnyB76 on the Twitter.
Speaking of Belgium.
Yeah, speaking of Belgium, he sent us a box of beer, and today we're going to take on one of my favorite styles, and that's imperial beers, and especially those big barrel-aged beers.
Surprised you like Belgian triples, though.
Well, I like them because they're stronger, mostly, and I don't know that I've had a bourbon barrel Belgian before, so
yeah,
we're going to take on this beer. It's called the Curieux. I'm assuming that's how you pronounce it, from Allagash. And
well, I'm assuming this is one of those that would have fit in that barrel-aged strong beer category.
Right.
So, yeah.
But also in the Belgian, probably in the Belgian category.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, so anyways, after this, we're going to be talking about Allagash's Curieux. Hey, Dustin.
Hey, Mark.
Hey, you know, one thing I bet you couldn't get, despite the fact that you're Dustin the Whale, I know you could not get in Vegas.
Just the furry whale.
Yeah, you're just a furry whale. But you couldn't get in Vegas, and that is Pine Hub. I know you went up there, you slapped him in the face with your phone, said, MF-er, I'm Dustin the Whale. I'm dressed as a whale, as a furry whale. I don't know if I have scales or skin or what, but I want a beer. And
I had a burlap sack on for my costume.
And I want it on my Pine Hub app. Right.
Absolutely.
Now.
I demanded a pediculus velvet hammer, and they threw me out on my whale ass.
They did. And you took your money, and you ran home. You took off your whale costume, and you were crying.
I was, yes.
Into your generic.
The whole way down the strip, I was crying.
Your generic light lager that you had to get from Beverage City or whatever.
Absolutely.
Whatever generic store. But the good thing about living in Dallas, one of the few good things about living in Dallas, other than our access to craft beer, is the Pine Hub app. Because right now,
it's good to be home, Mark.
We are the exclusive home of Pine Hub. Although that may not last long, because they are trying to expand to other cities for their business' sake. I'm assuming they want to be, you know, even more profitable.
It's funny. Funny how businesses work.
Business.
Yes.
We should be the CNBC cast. So you can get Pine Hub for $1 for your very first month. Just use the code BREWBLOODS, and that allows you to get your first beer on the house every single day. Just go to some lovely joint like one of our favorite places, Craft and Growler.
Absolutely. They have such a large selection. You want to go there 5, 6, 7 days a week, $1 a day. I totally understand. They have enough beer to definitely cover that.
And you can stay there 24/7. If you're there and you've got the Pine Hub app, they're not going to close down. Don't tell them that's true. I don't know if that's true or not. But I'm going to say, if you have the Pine Hub app and you get your first free beer, they're going to say, we're going to stay open 24/7.
I'm going to say that. It's probably not true, but I'll say that.
It's probably not true. There's a disclaimer at the bottom of this podcast. But you'll have to read that. It's all legalese. We had a lawyer. We had a team of lawyers.
That is not saying things that are true. But yeah.
They may or may not stay open for you. But if you use Pine Hub, you will at least get your first beer on the house. And you try something you've never had before, like maybe a Dutch over from the Pegasus City Brewery, something I've never had.
Yeah, me neither.
Never had anything by Pegasus City, and that's on me, not on them.
Yes.
But you can also try things like the Tejano Pecano from Oak Highlands, which I highly enjoy. That's a really great pecan beer. Had that at the Draft House recently. You could have the 667 Neighbor of the Beast from Lone Pint Brewery. We've done their Yellow Rose before.
Neighbor of the
great
Beast.
Brewery.
Neighbor very creative.
Of the Beast. Yes, very. So anyways, go to Craftsman Growler if you want to, or any other participating restaurants or joints that subscribe to Pine Hub. And open up the app, show them that
open
beer
up the
that
app,
you want.
Look at the map, see where you are, see what's around you.
Let's you know. Open the map, look. Open the app, look at the map.
There you go. Yeah, exactly. They need to incorporate that.
And get what's on tap.
There you go.
Thanks to Pine Hub. $1 for your very first month. Get your first beer on the house every single day. Open the app.
Free
go
beer
to the
day.
Map,
where else you get that?
And get a beer on tap. Pine Hub. So Allagash Brewing Company, somebody we are not familiar with.
I have no idea. Never heard of them.
You've never heard of Allagash?
No.
I can't believe you've not. I understand you've never had their stuff because they're nowhere near us, but I'm surprised you've never
I may
heard
have come
of
across them, to be honest. I just don't remember.
Well, they are one of those breweries that it seems to me, my perception is that they have a high reputation up there with as far as respectable quality as I would put probably towards Pediculus, or somebody might put towards Russian River, or somebody might
put towards
I don't know, McKellar or somebody like that. Like, that's kind of the perception I get.
Sam
never
Adams.
Had one of their beers before. Sam Adams, Budweiser, maybe a nice Coors Light, Azima even.
Yeah, there you go.
But yeah, I that's the perception I get.
This concludes Mark's wild speculation.
My wild speculation on breweries I never had. So they're coming from Portland, Maine, up in from the Northeast, the Allagash Curieux. And our old pal, our probably most loyal of listeners, Johnny B76, old Johnny Barbosa on the Untaps, sent us this beer a while ago. So it's been aging comfortably.
I would
my
say
cellar.
He's probably definitely the number one listener.
Yeah, he's our definite big, strong P1.
We know we at least have one listener out there because of Johnny B.
Yeah, that's true. Probably our only listener. And he sent us this beer. This is the Curieux. And if you guys want to send us beer or do a beer exchange, we're more than happy to do that. We have done several in the past.
We have all kinds of Sierra Nevadas to send you.
We do. And a few Zimas. This is the Curieux, C-U-R-I-E-U-X. I'm assuming I'm saying that right. And
Curieux.
It was bottled. nice throwback. Curieux. That's a Sopranos reference.
That is, yes.
Not subscribed to the HBO. So
Sopranos reference to Furio, never seen it.
The random disappearance of Furio.
Yes.
And that concludes our Carmelo Soprano impression segments of the show.
Probably your Soprano talk in general.
Curio is an ale aged in oak bourbon barrels.
In a boat.
In a boat. And this is a Belgian triple, which is an interesting combo because I've never had a bourbon barrel aged Belgian.
And they say it ages only for 7 weeks, so it's not like a long time. But, you know, I don't know how that compares actually to like KBS and how long they're in the caves and stuff like that. I used to know that, but I have since drank that information out of my head. But 7 weeks seems like seems a little bit short, but that doesn't necessarily mean it won't pick up all the characteristics. Maybe that's pretty standard.
Yeah, and apparently they brewed this first back in 2004, and it was their first experiment with barrel aging. So they take it, they take their Belgian triple, let it age in bourbon barrels for, like as you said, 7 weeks. Then they take it out of the cold cellars and blend it back in with a portion of fresh triple. And what you should expect to taste out of this beer is rich golden ale taste, featuring smooth notes of coconut, vanilla, and a hint of bourbon. Now, usually what we get out of these bourbon barrel beers is just a smash in the face.
Yeah, Like again, that kind of speaks to 7 weeks being short. If you only have a hint of bourbon plus the mixture of fresh Belgian on top of that,
right?
Or fresh triple on top of that. So yeah, you know, and golden ales are not. I wouldn't say I really adamantly dislike them, but they're not my favorite. I think they're kind of bland. It's kind of like having a standard porter or something. But the fact that they are going to mix in, you have notes of coconut and vanilla, and then the hint of bourbon. I think it has a potential to be really tasty because coconut and vanilla are two of my favorite flavors.
This one does weigh in at 11% ABV, so quite stout. It was bottled on this one was particularly bottled in May 2017, so not that long ago.
Yeah, but we're coming up on about a year.
This one actually says on the side of the bottle, although the official description says 7 weeks, this says 8 weeks. So maybe this is a extra old man version.
Maybe
an
so.
Entire other week.
The official description came from their website.
Yeah,
so they're contradicting themselves.
I think that might be what we call in the business fake news.
Yeah, their own website is fake news.
Exactly. Now, Johnny himself left a review on Untappd for this, and we'll just go ahead and read this. He says, beautifully balanced with hints of coconut, vanilla, and bourbon. Super light and refreshing, extremely easy to drink for an 11% ABV beer. And Bert Lynch, another one of our P1s, actually reviewed this, and he said, going back to the craft beer I was first introduced to, but my good buddy Dane, the one that got me started on a good beer kick. So I guess this must be a hell of a beer to get you started with.
Well, you know, it did win bronze in the World Beer Cup in 2008, so that's a good start. The ratings for it are actually quite phenomenal. You know, a 98 overall and 99 in style for rate beer. And Untappd, a 4.10 out of 5 on 76,780 unique reviews. I mean, that is a load of reviews.
That is.
And then even Beer Advocate gives it 4.28 out of 5. So,
which is very strong for them.
All of those are pretty strong. I mean, again, like we said before, Untappd, you know, anything over 4, you're starting to get in pretty good territory. And then just that many reviews to still be that high, that says a lot.
So let's start with the appearance on this beer. Now, the bottle itself is, I don't know, reminds me a lot more of a wine bottle than it does a beer bottle.
Because, oh, very much so, yes.
You know, as we in the craft beer game know, we tend to be a little more brash than our wine brethren.
Yeah.
This is a classy, upstanding bottle. Like, you could see this being served at Three Forks or something.
Well, you know, it's kind of an amalgam as well, because you have the actual name, and then the barrels above the name look very wine-ish, but then you have the brewery name that's kind of bold.
Yeah,
Allagash. So it's kind of a mixture, and I do kind of like that. It's interesting.
Hey, guys, it's me.
Mixture?
No. Allagash.
I was going to say, you're really stretching it with mixture, but...
I'm a lady of the night. Want to see my last name up close?
We'll see you later, Ali. Have nothing.
Still here.
Let's blow you up.
Miss Cash is here.
So, appearance.
I'm bloody.
Deep yellow. Deep yellow to deep golden in color. This one, let's look through the light, the tiny light we have yet again here. I would say it's probably more on the golden spectrum.
Yeah, it's definitely golden.
Yeah.
And if you take it out of the proper sunlight, which I don't like to have here, but in the proper sunlight, it is a quite bright golden color, like the color of almost the color of straw, almost.
Yeah, I would say so. Yeah, and it's thick; you can't really see through it. Maybe directly in the light you can, but I mean, if you're just looking in just partial light, like I get on my cave side of the room. It looks like I can't see you through it at all. I can't see anything through it.
And normally that's how we judge it, is can we see each other through the beer?
Exactly. We just gaze into each other's eyes.
Gaze deeply.
You don't know how much stuff we edit out of us just staring at each other. It's like dead air for 30 minutes.
Oh, yeah. No. One time we set a record of like 98 minutes of just staring at each other through
the
beer.
We ran out of a card, you know, card space on the recorder. So
We're drinking these out of tulips. And I would say...
Not the flower, but the...
No, I'm drinking out of an actual flower. It is tulip season.
Right.
I would say that this thing has retained its head quite nicely because it's been probably 10 minutes since it was poured.
Yeah, you poured it, then went and photoed it around your luxurious pool, and it's still there. So, yeah, it's pretty good little amount of time.
I don't really care about lacing, but lacing on the glass is nice if you're a fan of lacing. Yeah. If you're a fan of a...
It's something to note.
A lacy bustier on your Allagash.
It's definitely very lacy, yeah.
Then it's very lacy and a very white head.
I'm remembering the lacing.
Well, that's a callback for two.
That is.
Remembering lacing.
If Billy's listening, he'll get it too.
Billy's not listening.
Good point. So what's up next? Aroma?
Aroma would be... Not a hot alcohol or solventy aroma. Malt character should be light. No diacetyl, which I would hope not in most cases. Can be spicy, peppery, sometimes clove-like. Esters can be reminiscent of citrus fruits such as oranges, but may have a slight banana character.
Yeah. No diacetyl is nice. Why would we have that? Yeah.
I'm not a diacetyl fan.
Yeah. Until we drink something from or smell something from, like Jester King, I don't expect diacetyl to be involved.
Or just drinking popcorn butter.
Yeah, there you go.
That's what we should make is a popcorn butter stout.
Right.
And we can hope for popcorn long while we're at it.
There's a little bit of spice in there. It's not overwhelming, though.
My allergies are effing with me something hard today.
Yeah.
So it's kind of hard for me to get a full aroma. But it's clovey.
You're clogged. You're clogged up.
It's just, constant flow of snot directly into my tulip glass. It's just a... You know that song, River of God?
It's like a little kid who ran outside during the winter and he just got the snot running down his face. That's what Mark has. It's just going into his mouth and he's looping it around.
And that Christian hymn, River of God, I rewrote that just for my nose.
River of snot?
Yep. Keeps my nose a-flowing.
So we got flavor and mouthfeel. That's all we got left here, right? So light to medium body, I would kind of expect that.
Yep, a marriage of spicy, fruity, and alcohol flavors supported by a soft malt character and... can be higher carbonation, but the alcohol should add a pleasant creaminess, but little to no obvious warming.
Yeah, no hot alcohol solventy. So that's kind of like what Johnny's review said.
Yeah, I don't want a solventy flavor in my beer.
Yeah, I know.
It's never nothing I want to be able to clean up vomit with.
Right, and I don't like hot alcohol flavoring in this. I mean, if you just want to get plastered and I'm drinking pure gasoline Jameson, then you get a hot alcohol flavor. I don't really want hot alcohol flavor in beer very often. If at all.
So, to me, I would say the bourbon influence there is very light. Like, you can taste the wood. Like, you just got a fresh oak barrel. You need shave off a sliver there to pick your teeth with.
They did say hint.
A hint. It is a hint. I'll give it that. And so, that's very accurately described. A lot of banana.
I do get the coconut. Just a hint. I get a hint of the bourbon. Vanilla is... in the mix, but it's pretty light too. The majority character is the standard Belgian flavoring.
Yeah.
And the golden ale flavoring, which is a little disappointing to me, to be honest. But
what do you expect?
The other stuff is coming out better than I expected. I'd say hint, but as it actually sits on the back of my tongue, it kind of comes out a little bit more as you drink it more and as it's sitting there. You're right. It's a very powerful flavor. A Belgian triple flavor is very powerful to overcome with anything. So the fact that I'm getting all those notes is actually impressive and says a lot about the beer.
It's very effervescent.
Oh, yeah.
It's quite the tongue tickler, which is nice because who doesn't love a tongue tickling?
Yeah, it's kind of refreshing. It's like a refreshing feeling drinking it.
Yes, it's perfect for summer day, maybe reading your financial statements by the pool, something like that.
Maybe cleaning the blood leg off with that.
Maybe cleaning some blood leg like I have right now.
He's got snot face and blood leg. He's really falling apart over there.
I am. I don't know what it is to me, but I actually detect solventy flavors in that or something. Now, it may just be me. Maybe my screwed up allergies. I fully contend there may be something fully wrecking my palate right now. That's entirely possible. It's not.
I don't get hot alcohol, but I do get what you mean about. Yeah,
it may just be my tongue perceiving those flavors as a combo.
Yeah,
it's not like pledge or something harsh, but it's a little lemon. I say pledge. It's a little lemon pledgy. I'm not saying it's bad. It's just.
Yeah, I know what you mean because I don't know if it's the combo of the coconut and the standard Belgian grassy flavor. There's something that's playing together that's a little bit odd. It's like school, like people are in the schoolyard fighting and they don't really get along as well as they should. And that's kind of, to me, like the, I feel like the sweet characteristic of the coconut and vanilla is kind of mixing a little bit weird with the grassy flavor of a standard triple to me. I don't know if I like that combo that much. It's all there and it's impressive that they got it all there. And as it sits, you know, you get that initial grassy flavor. It kind of goes away a little bit. And then after that, the coconut and the kind of hint of wood and the hint of vanilla kind of hang around. But it's kind of like a weird, it's like a weird second flavoring. Like, it's there, it's impressive it's there, but it's a little bit odd to me that it's there.
Yeah, it's, I'll give it this, it's very well balanced.
Yeah.
Like, there's not one flavor that really overpowers another one, I would say.
True.
The strongest flavor is the Belgian, is that Belgian earthiness.
Yeah.
Which, it's a Belgian beer, so it's what you expect. Yeah. But like the bourbon, not one of these team players. Well, they're all being team players. Yeah. None of them stand out. There's no I in this team, other than Belgian.
Yeah,
those stupid Belgians always being the I in team.
Right.
Other than that, they're all. It's very well. It's just very well balanced beer. I'll give it that. I don't know that It's not my favorite flavor by any stretch.
Yeah.
And it's not a bad beer, but it's actually, I would say, as Belgians go, it's one of the best Belgians I've had.
Well, you know, to me, I think everything they did with the bourbon barrel aging and the vanilla and the coconut would be great if it was a different base beer. That's my whole problem.
Yeah,
but that's my Belgian problem.
I agree with you. I think this is probably more on us than it is Allagash.
Yeah.
Because I think this is, as I said, one of the better Belgians I've had in my lifetime. And
He's had so many Belgians.
So many lifetimes. Yeah. So many Belgians.
Yeah.
Going back to
in every which way Prussian
War.
You can possibly mean that.
Yes.
Yeah.
I've taken so many lives. Infrequently Belgian lives. That's what I strive to take.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, I'm the San Francisco, what's the killer that was just recently found? I'm
the Golden Gate Killer?
The Golden Gate Killer, but for Belgium. That's me.
Yeah, that's his full name. The Golden Gate Killer, but for Belgium.
But for Belgium. It's very confusing.
Yeah, it's weird, yeah.
And it goes back to the Franco-Prussian War. It's very strange.
Yeah,
very strange.
Yeah, it's got deep roots that we don't need to dive into.
Right now. Really. We can. That's another podcast. That's the next season of Serial that'll never come out. It's very well balanced. I think the solvent flavor here, for lack of a better term, this is going to sound bad, astringent flavor.
Yeah, the pledge flavor.
I think that's just me not liking Belgians as a category most of the time.
Or a people.
Or a people. Yeah. I mean, all I go into Belgians for is waffles.
Right.
I mean,
yeah,
you could take the waffles, leave the Belgians.
Mm-hmm.
I don't need Belgians for anything else.
Unless you keep them to make waffles.
Unless it's New Belgium.
Yeah.
Now, New Belgium, but that's a whole other country.
Yeah,
that's
new. Yeah.
It's new. It's new. It's brand new. It's brand new Belgium. it's Belgium, but with America in it.
And, you know, I don't know how different this would have been had we not had it a year out, too. I don't know when they expect you to drink it, how long you're supposed to age it.
I mean, granted, it's been sitting in my fridge for a while.
Yeah. It's been refrigerated at least.
Yeah,
so.
But I mean, high BV beers, barrel aged.
It should be okay.
It should be fine.
Yeah, no, I agree. It should be fine.
Like I said, I think it's a very well balanced beer. I think it's one of the best Belgians I've ever had. It's just, I don't think my palate cares for Belgians that Belgian
exists
that most people seem to appreciate that you and I cannot get behind.
Yeah, I know. I've tried, and I've tried a lot.
I've tried
a lot of Belgian beers.
And I'm to keep trying.
Yeah,
it's like sours. Like it took me a long time to put my sour pants on.
I'm just not sure when I'm going to like lawn clippings. That's my thing. It's hard.
But you know,
Belgians
that,
to me taste like lawn. That's,
you know, we should do. We should go back and we should revisit as an experiment our first craft beers, because my first craft beer that I enjoyed was the Fancy Lawnmower from St. Arnold, which tastes like that retronasal conversion of smell to taste of a fresh cut lawn.
Yeah, true.
At least it did with a hint of cherries, I should add.
Yeah. But you had a very underdeveloped palate at that time. You had a wee palate.
Again, and
it was
I
a baby
haven't
palate.
Had it in probably a decade.
Yeah.
So I'd be interested to go back and try that. But I enjoyed, maybe my palate has changed. I used to hate broccoli. Eat broccoli all the time now.
True.
I'm a big boy.
You do that. You do that and I'll get a Franconia wheat. I love that.
What was your first craft beer? I can't remember.
That was one of the very first ones. I think Hoegaarden maybe was
okay,
the very first one.
Okay, well,
we could do Hoegaarden and Fancy Lawnmower.
Why not?
Just see what those are now, yeah.
And we should also do Solus White, because that's, you know,
That's a thing that's come back.
Yeah, what's his name? Mr. Hogarden. He started Hogarden. Sellis started Hogarden.
Hey, they even have that at our local Kroger's.
They do. So anyways, well, we back to Allagash.
Yeah. Not to things you don't care about.
Yeah. Anyways. Yeah, I think this is on us. I don't think this is on Allagash. I think for me, I'm going to say this is a great version of a Belgian. And if I had to pick a Belgian to drink, this is going to be the one I'm going to drink based on previous experiences.
Sure.
I think it's awesome how well balanced it is that outside of Belgian earthiness, because they're so earthy, they're so quammy.
So earthy.
So quammy. Yeah. So Captain Planety.
Yeah.
So Gaia, spirit of the earth. Outside of that.
I mean, I'll finish this. I don't hate it for sure.
I don't hate it. I just don't like that. Those earthy notes. That's all it is.
It's just like lagers. I try different types of lagers too, just to see if I'll ever like it. I'm not trying to be cool beer guy that just hates lagers because Budweiser makes them or whatever. I've tried them. I tried the Vienna lager from Lakewood. I still don't like it that much. I try it. It's something about that flavor I just don't like. The same thing with Belgians. It's just I try it, but you know, I'm thinking one of these. That's why I was excited about this one, because it had the modifications. I thought maybe this would be a little bit different.
Yeah.
And it is different, but it's still. It's just not quite there. It's still got the stuff I don't like in it.
I do like how playful it is. I like how well balanced it is. I think again, I agree with you. If it was a different base beer for me, it would be a better beer.
Yeah.
Like if it were, let's say, even a Pilsner.
Yeah.
Maybe a more neutral Pilsner. Maybe this would make those other flavors come out more. I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm no brewer.
I've had Kolsches that have like vanilla flavoring and stuff, and I like those. You know, something that's not as harsh as.
Or maybe a non Belgian golden ale.
Yeah.
Like I would say. You know, locally,
like the mustache from
the hot fusion,
right?
Their golden ale, not the Dallas blonde, that's Deep Ellum. anyways,
yeah,
their golden ale, fantastic beer. I think maybe a more bland palate to start with for a beer, would make those other characters come out better, and I think it would be a better beer, because I actually would love to taste more coconut, more vanilla, like me too. Still keep the balance, but make them come up a little more.
Absolutely.
I think I would like that more personally.
Yep, but I agree. That's me. Nope, we're in the same boat.
That's me, Miss Vegas.
Yeah.
I mean,
that's our problem. That's our palate problem.
I'm going to try to rate this. I'm going to rate this based on how I perceive it, and that is being a damn fine Belgian, and one I would definitely drink again. I'm definitely open to, if somebody wants to send us more of these, I'll definitely drink them.
And we now rate these on a 10 to 1,000 thumb rating system.
Yeah. I'm gonna give this beer like 5 thumbs up, 1 sideways, and 1 down, just because I'm not a Belgian fan.
Yeah.
So that's what, 7.5 to 8 thumbs up and a half down, just because I would like to see the same recipe on a different base beer. That's it. I think it's a very. I have said enough. That's enough. Yeah. I talked enough.
To me. The fact that
this I'm going to keep talking right now for another 5 minutes. I'm going to keep on rambling.
Okay.
No, go ahead.
So,
don't interrupt me. I'm here talking about Curieux.
God damn it.
Keep going.
So to me,
God, just talk already.
The fact that it is drinkable enough that I am enjoying it and I will drink the whole thing, that says a lot. I do feel like my mouth will be a desert after I do it, because that's what Belgian beers always do to me. They dry me out. I feel like beef jerky after I drink them, but that's how it is.
You're more of a Jack Link beef jerky?
Yeah, any kind of beef jerky you want to name. It's the most high-end one because it's me.
Sure.
But anyway.
You're Dustin the Whale. You're whale jerky.
There you go. But so for me, the thumb system's going to go, I'm going to give it 10 thumbs up, 32 and a half thumbs sideways, and like 4 thumbs down.
That's a pretty bold.
I'm giving it a lot of thumbs sideways because it's very neutral to me.
You end up with a neutral 28 thumbs.
Yes,
because you subtracted 4 thumbs.
That's true. Yeah.
So you had 28 thumbs and what, 4 sideways?
Yeah.
So 28.75 thumbs. Something like that.
4 down, 32 and a half sideways.
Yeah, there's math in there. There's thumb math in there, and we are not.
There's a half one in there too. Yeah. It's kind of weird. Like a half cut thumb.
I didn't know we were going over 10 thumbs. I thought we were on a 1 to 10 thumb scale.
It's a 10 to 1,000.
Oh, that's true. You did mention that. Yeah. And I wasn't listening to you.
Yeah.
But it was still
way less than 1,000, but I still gave it a lot of thumbs. And a lot of sideways. I think sideways is very fair for this one.
Yes.
And probably thumbs up if you like Belgian beers. This is probably a really good one.
I think if you really like Belgians, I think this is a home run beer.
Yeah.
This, just the fact that, I mean, you and I, as our wives commented last night, I mean, we're pretty much twinsies here. I mean, we're both wearing cargo shorts right now.
Yeah.
Black shirts. We're both wearing black shirts. Yeah. We're both bearded.
Yeah.
Our main difference is you have an abundance of hair. You were visited by the hair fairy. You have a Jay Leno haircut.
Yeah, that's true.
I am the opposite of that. Yeah. My hair is receded into my head.
That's true.
Yeah. And my beard is about the same length for once. Yeah, and true. I'm barefoot, and you're not barefoot. You're wearing sandals, water shoes.
You're bloody, I'm not bloody.
I've got blood leg, you don't have blood leg. True. Yeah.
But otherwise,
we're pretty much similar.
Yeah.
I mean...
That's just how it is.
It's so weird that we run, you know, we kind of run the same path in so many paths in our life, and it extends to taste.
Yeah, that's very true.
So...
That's our ratings.
That's our ratings, yeah. So yeah.
If you like Belgians, go grab this beer. If you don't, you still might at least be able to tolerate it. If someone pours you one, you won't hate it. I'll put it that way.
What a resounding review. You won't hate it.
That says a lot, though, for a category that I avoid all the time. To say I could drink it and someone pours one, I would drink it. That's a ringing endorsement from our perspective.
And that, in and of itself, is worth 55 thumbs up.
Absolutely.
Thanks for listening to yet another episode of Brew Bloods. If you're not subscribed to the show, you should be. It's absolutely free, and you can subscribe anywhere fine podcasts can be found. Through Apple Podcasts, Google Music, Spotify, or any podcast app out there. Above all, please tell a friend about us. We'd really appreciate it. If you want to reach out to us, you can find us as at Brew Bloods on all the social networks, or email us at brewbloodsshow@gmail.com. That's brewbloodsshow@gmail.com. So for everyone here at Brew Bloods, this is Mark saying Prost.